Okay, I guess we can start now. So my name is Andy Kleen, and I'm talking about GCC link time optimization and the Linux kernel. And this is actually more about the compiler than the kernel. But my background is actually kernel. So I'm not like a professional compiler developer or anything. So you might ask me something about the compiler that I don't know. But let's see how far we get. And this was more a little bit of a hobby project for me. I did it over a long time, mostly on weekends. So it actually took a long time. It took over a year to get it booted. So just a lot of people helped me on this, just very quick, especially Honzo Bika and AJ Liu with a lot of changes that are needed for this. And lots of other people helped me doing this. So it was contribution from others. So why LTO? So you want to optimize over the world binary. So initially, like before 3.0, GCC only optimized per function, global optimizer, and then in 3.0 it got like per file, so did IPA. But then in LTO, you want to optimize over the complete program. And you could do this before, but it was pretty complicated because you had to change your make files a lot. So LTO is basically pushing the optimization phase towards the link time. And especially one thing where I'm interested in, especially for kernel, is so kernel has a lot of what's called include hell. So where you have inline files and includes, and because the inlines often need a lot of other dependencies, sometimes there's something you cannot do inline because you get a loop in the inline dependencies. I had a few things where I couldn't do something, simply of course this problem. So, but if you have the capability to actually inline without having includes, so without having it in a header file, then you could avoid this problem. And it would, I mean, one problem is that it slows down the build somewhat because the header file is getting bigger and bigger and bigger. So there's some other issues. Another motivation for LTO is you don't want to change the make file significantly. So people actually did it before, like global optimization, by just including everything in a file. Or there was used to be a GCC option which did this kind of automatically. But this is very intrusive, especially large systems are very complicated build systems. And it's very intrusive, so it's much better to have something which is relatively plug-in, so you can just plug in into existing makefiles. That's LTO. So the LTO, originally in 4.5, GCC got the first LTO, but it did have some limitations, and later in 4.6 and 4.7, especially, there's something called WOPR, which is more or less parallel LTO, so that you don't, because otherwise, if you do all the optimizations in a single thread at link time, that's just too slow. It doesn't scale. So they switched over to doing it in multiple phases. I'm just giving you a very quick overview because I'm talking about some of the details later. But essentially, you start off with what's called LGAN. So this is just the standard parsing and then generating code. And also you compute some optimization summaries. And traditional LTO actually generated code at this point, what's called FAT LTO. So you did the full code optimization, but you also put the immediate language also in the object files. So you essentially generated everything twice. Then the next step is when you essentially go to the linker detects that the object file contains LTO data and then calls back to LTO1, so the compiler, and then it first analyzes all the dependencies. So it does a global call graph and looks at the types and just merges the types, which are different, and does some more summaries, but doesn't actually look at all the actual code. It just looks at the summaries. And then it generates partitions, so which is kind of like a part of the call graph, which is together, so you can optimize it together. And then eventually it actually calls the back end, so that's called L-trans, on each partition in parallel, so it actually generates a make file and runs it with make minus j. And then it does inlining inside the partition. It runs optimizations between functions, so global optimizations for real. And does then optimize the functions again, so does the backend. And finally generates object code. So that's the current scheme in GCC. And the goal of this partition scheme is basically to do as much as works possible parallel. because we do everything single-threaded, it's just too slow. Yeah, it's like if you build a large system with make minus j1, nobody does that anymore. So there are a lot of optimizations which can be enabled by LTO. I mean, it doesn't support all optimizations, because some optimizations always need to look at global state. So it kind of relies on optimizations which first generate a summary, and later on you can actually work on the summary. And I mean, especially the optimizations I'm interested in, for example, inlining, I think is very important. This was one of my primary motivations. Then you can do function cloning for specific arguments, so that if something is always called with a specific constant, you can make a special version of it. You can remove unused code. I personally didn't consider that too important, but some of my users do. They're very interested in code size. You can increase alignment. For example, something's vectorized is normally not used in a con. Then you can discover poor const. What's interesting is if it looks at everything, it can actually keep some, it cache some globals and statics and registers, because it can prove that a function call doesn't clobber that register. That can be, in some cases, can give you a nice improvement. Then devitalization is very interesting, but right now we cannot use it in the kernel. That's everything that's green, somewhat confusing, is what I currently cannot use in the kernel. Then change ABI. This is useful for vectorization, but it's not in the kernel. Constant propagation. Replacing structures with individual variables. This can sometimes give large wins, because you might actually put part of the structure in the register. So I had actually cases in kernel benchmarks where such an optimization gave me real numbers, so like 2%. But this was a very big benchmark, so 2% was a big improvement, because people do a lot of work for 2%. But this can be also done globally, and constructor to structure merging. I would actually like to use this at some point, but right now it's because the kernel doesn't use standard destructors or constructors, so it doesn't work. So these are the optimizations that can be enabled by this over the complete program. So build time. Build time, I mean, it's somewhat slower, you can see. So the first ones, so it's with LTO, with minus LTO means without LTO. So, I mean, it definitely costs you. Significantly in build time is more than 4 or 5 times slower. So this is a small config. the user time, I mean, if you look at the parallelism, it's also somewhat slower. Especially a computer, the parallelism, so that's the user time was divided by the real time. And you can see that LTO is a lot less parallel than the non-LTO. Yeah. So there's definitely got some things. And it also has a lot more memory consumption. For example, here I have the minor faults. And LTO does a lot more minor faults. So 4.8 is slightly slower, but not very much. Actually, first, when I did a lot of my benchmarks, at first I thought 4.8 was a lot slower than 4.7 in LTO. But then I figured out I actually had some debug option enabled. So it was a mistake. But so mostly it's very similar. I think the difference is slightly more for non-LTO than for LTO. But it's not a big difference. So the performance in terms of build time is mostly common. But in general, I mean, it costs you. So it's, the build time is slow, and the parallelism is not good enough. So especially I was looking a little bit more at looking at the parallelism problem. So this is just plotting the runnable. So I basically just did a VM stat over the build, and just plotting how many processes are runnable. So you can see at the beginning, this is the LGen phase, where it actually just reads all the source code files and generates the objects. This is pretty parallel. I mean, this is how it works. This is on a system with, I run it with 16 threads, so 16 CPU threads, like 8 core, 16 threads. then at some point, there's a long phase, which is VPA, a WPA, where it's not so parallel. Then it does generates something parallel again. So you actually see this happens 3 times. One of the reasons is that this is the kernel uses something called KL-SIMS, where essentially it wants to build in its symbol table. Unfortunately, it does multiple links to do this, because it first has to generate a link, then create a symbol table, then link again to put in the symbol table it generated from the first link. And you have to do this multiple steps, because something can change. And this costs you, yeah, because it's essentially with LTO, you're doing a large part of your optimization this multiple times. But unfortunately, I cannot disable LTO, sorry, K scale them in our cases, so still have to do this here. So anyways, you see that there's some parallelism issues, especially in between, at the beginning of the LTO. There's a long phase where things are not parallel, essentially single-threaded. Another interesting quirk you can see at the end, this is my modules. So this is as a config was mostly static, but had a few modules. And normally, when the modules run, there's a bug currently in job server. So job server is the mechanism in make that the sub makes don't generate too many jobs. They always ask the main make for the job. But the job server currently doesn't work when you run it from LTO, so passing through. Or there's a bug sometimes. Sometimes it fails. So it has to be disabled, and this causes these spikes at the end. So that it actually generates more jobs than configured. So I hope that will be fixed at some point, but right now the bug is still there. So you can see, one problem is the four times linking, or 3 to 4 times. But the other problem is there's the long phase, which is essentially single-threaded. So I already mentioned this, so it's been 2 and 4 times. You can actually disable it, but normally it's extremely useful to have the symbol table in the kernel, because otherwise if something crashes, it's much harder to figure out what's going on. And there are various features in the kernel which depend on it. So right now this is not fixed. Actually, we tried to fix it, so by changing part of the link over to be an incremental link. But currently it generates kernels which don't boot at all, even without LTO. So I haven't traced down yet what the problem is. So I hope it will get fixed, but right now it's still there. So here are some differences, for example. If you disable KLSIMS, how much faster it gets with LTO, so it costs you about 2/3 of the build time currently if you run it on a LATA system. I don't have the 4.8 number here, but it's fairly similar, 2.47. So then I was looking more at the memory usage, because as that was problems with memory. If you look at the minor faults, so the graph at the bottom, the minor faults definitely go up quite a lot. And this is even with 2 megabyte pages. So actually, I did some tuning on the GCC garbage collector to map better to 2 megabyte pages with transparent huge pages. But even with that one, the minor faults are going up quite a lot. So, with 2 megabyte pages, you have less minor faults because every fault is 2 megabyte instead of 4K. But still, it's going up quite a lot. So, but the more interesting part is the active memory. I was plotting the same thing. And you can see, first there's quite an active memory use at the beginning, but it's not too bad. It's just about the same what you would expect from a normal build. This is just the LGen phases. But then there are always spikes in the middle, which is the type merging. So this is when it reads all the different information from all the object files, but they all have their own types, but it needs a global symbol table for global types. So it has to merge all these types together, and this causes very large memory spikes. Another problem I had at the beginning, this was back in the 4.6 times, I had temp equals tempfs, and GCC, the driver, puts the partitions into temp. So the problem is there were some issues with the way the partitioning was done. So it was putting a lot of data into temp, and then it was also using a lot of data to do type merging and generating code and so on. And all of this, I cut some really nice swap storms. So first thing was don't put temp into tempfs, and build your program with tempdir equals objectdir. So don't put the temporary files of the compiler into tempfs, because otherwise you can, with temp equals tempfs, you can compete essentially with all the memory consumption. The other problem is, what's also difficult is because there's a problem with job server, which you probably need to fix. Too large minus J with large modules can also cause memory problems. So because then if you're really unlucky and the type merging phase of a large module comes together with the VM Linux, you might also exceed your memory. So you have to be a little bit careful with all of that. Also that the partition algorithm got a lot better with 4.7 and also 4.8. So it's got a lot better in terms of how much data it generates, but I still recommend to not put the tempdir into tempfs. This can still cause problems. So here's a large build. So this is the the all yes build. So this is a much larger configuration. It's basically you enable everything you can and put it into the main VMlog. This is like the worst case for LTO in terms of memory consumption and build time and so on. So I mean, the build time is pretty long. I disabled the symbol table here now, so it only did the backend. But you see, I mean, that is like a 42 minutes on an 8-core system. So it's really quite a substantial operation. With KLSIMS, it's even longer. And I currently have, with that one, I have a 15-gigabyte peak. So you definitely cannot compile it on your laptop, unless you have a really big laptop. I mean, I should add, this is a somewhat unrealistic configuration, because normally people don't use all yes. Yeah, it's more like you test something. But I mean, it's still an interesting test case for GCC. So you can see, I mean, the memory can go up quite a bit. And there's a really long phases, again, which are single-threaded. And this is actually, most of it is the type merging. So I actually have, I can't prove it here. I profiled it. And you can see here, I mean, most of the time spent is just merging, looking up hash tables, and most of it is type merging. I was actually told, but especially by Honza, who did a lot of work like on Mozilla with LTO, he said he thinks that something, the way the kernel does types, is the worst case. It's worse than other programs. I cannot tell you if that's true or not, but at least I know that I spend a lot of time in type merging. So I actually spent some time looking at this and trying to get it faster. So I mean, type merging is actually a somewhat complicated problem, because in the tree data structures that GCC uses, essentially when you have a type, like for example, struct foo and two pointers, then you have a recursive data structure, which then points to all these things. And this has to be all unified. So you have different versions from every object file, and has to be all unified into one. Yeah? And so essentially, it's doing hashes with iterative hashing, iteratively hashing the objects, and then putting it all in there. The thing exactly has two different hash tables. And then this is a really scary thing. I hadn't seen this before anywhere. Is it has hash functions which have another hash table as a cache. So it's a pretty, let's say, complicated operation. And I actually ended up with, in the large case, I ended up with several gigabytes of hash tables in the peak case, and was just spending a lot of time there. So I did some investigations how to make this faster. For example, one thing I tried is, because if you saw the earlier profile, a lot of time was actually spent in malloc, a little bit down there. So I tried tcmalloc instead, so that's the Google malloc. It actually was the biggest win. I got nearly 10% improvement. Unfortunately, I also increased the memory consumption about 35%. So it's faster, but it uses more memory. But it's, I mean, it's a pretty nice improvement. It might even be something interesting for general users in GCC. Investigate different malloc. There seems to be different some possibilities here. Then another thing I tried is, because I noticed that a lot of time was spent increasing the hash table, because it uses like a standard Knuth hash, and if the hash table fills up by 50%, it doubles it to the next prime. And it spent a lot of time resizing the hash table, and especially with my large hash table, which was over 2 gigabytes, it spent a lot of time just doubling it and then reallocating it and copying it and so on. So one experiment I did was with the small setup. I was to just set it. I did a tunable for the hash sizes and just started off with the mains with the actual the target size. So I knew it before, I measured it before, and started off with the size. There's a similar technique like was, for example, a thread sanitizer in a previous talk was using. You say, virtual memory is free. I just pre-allocate it. I might not use all of it, but I can use it. So it's actually a valid technique. Yeah? So you could say, I mean, it might in some cases use some more memory, because if you don't compress the hash table by a smaller hash table, the hash by hash table, you might still use more memory. But if you don't use too much of the hash table, it's still valid to have, like, just allocate a really large space and use it without paying the overhead of regularly copying it and doubling it and so on. So this gave me something like about 4%. This is about something like 2%. So starting with the full hash on the small. Yeah. Is there a question?
The labels are mystified. What is
0%. So, I mean, the chart is just various deltas I got from the improvements, yeah? So and these are the deltas in terms of build time. And this was more config, so you see larger improvements if you use the large config. The y-axis is the delta in build time in sec, as in percent of seconds. So, so another thing I tried was to improve the hashing. So I used the MUMA hash instead of the J hash. And the other thing I did multiple changes. So one thing I also noticed is that there's actually a large what's called pointer hashing where it actually just hashes pointers. It's a somewhat weird concept, but it does it. You can see it here in the pointer map. There's a pointer map in there. But the pointer hashing was not actually using all the bits of the pointer. So I just changed it first to a different hash function, but also just using all bits there. And the other thing I did is, what it did was a little bit weird is, so it generated a J hash and finalized the J hash, but then it did iteration on the J hash. So it took the final value and added, hashed more values in there. Yeah? But most of the iterative hashes I was looking at was actually, they keep like an expanded internal representation and just add more to it. So they, I mean, I'm not an expert on hash functions, but it seemed to me that would be probably a better way to mix all the hashes. So I switched over to MuMore, which is a modern hash, and it keeps an expanded internal representation and just add more to it. So this gives some movement. Anyways, for example, I was looking at the collisions, so the hash table data type in GCC looks at the collisions, and originally had over 90%, then I got back to 70%, and then 64% with these changes. So, and it gave me something like about 4% build time improvement for this case. So there was some improvements there, what you can do with the hashes, but even with that one, it was still pretty slow, I mean. I also tried display trees at some point, like GCC has a display tree. Actually, I don't have the numbers, but it was really, really slow. The display tree doesn't seem to perform very well, so I actually gave up. So I still think there must be probably some more changes in there. So in the future, it might be possible to do more on the hashing. So one idea I had, for example, was to pre-compute the hash in LGen and just stream it already in the object files. And then, from my understanding, the biggest problem with the hash table is that there's not enough locality of reference. So if you do hashing, you just jump all over several gigabytes of memory, and that's just slow. So the idea was, if you make the initial hash table large enough, and you pre-compute the hashes, you can stream out the types in the hash order. And then if you just fill in the types later, it should be like in the order of the hash table and not all over. But this only works because the initial phase doesn't know the collisions. So this only works when you make the hash tables large enough that you have very few collisions. Because otherwise, if you have a collision, then you're already out of order again. The other idea is, I'm not really sure if that will work or not, but the only merge per partition. So actually not do the merging before you do the partition, but do the merging in parallel when you do the partitions. But there might be some dragons there. So I'm not fully sure. And there might be other possibilities to parallelize and WPA further, but I'm not really sure. So incremental linking, this was another issue. I spent actually quite some time working on this. So the kernel build system uses LD minus R and AR extensively. And originally, the problem was that with LD minus R, if you only have LTO, so C files in there, that's okay. But if you also have some assembler files in there, .s files, they get thrown away during the LTO phase because the compiler reads in the object, but it just ignores everything it doesn't know about. And if there was any assembler in there, it was just disappeared. So obviously that didn't work for the kernel because it has not that many, but it has a substantial number of assembler files. Then the other problem was originally with LD minus R, there were the LTO objects segments, and they had all the same name. And what happened is the linker merges everything with the same name into the same section. But the problem was that then every function, or every individual object file, which was there before the LD-R, was all in a single section, and GCC didn't understand this. So you just had a lot of concatenated sections, but it was only looking at the beginning, so it didn't really work. The one thing I did was I just add random post fixes to the LTO sections, and then so that you have multiple ones that don't disappear during the LD-R. The problem was, originally I made the hash too small, so there were some really nasty build problems that sometimes in rare cases you had some weird linker errors. It turned out I needed to double the hash size of the random postfix, but then it worked. So, but anyways, there was still a problem there that you drop the assembler. So my original approach is I implemented what's called slim LTO, or the actual option is called non-fat LTO. So the idea was that you, because original GCC always generated everything twice. It generated it locally in the object file, so the binary in the object file, and then the LTO information. And then again, later on, when you do LTO, you read it back and you throw away the stuff which has been generated first. It has a few advantages if you generate it twice, especially sometimes when people make a mistake in the build system and something doesn't get LTO'd, then you have a fallback because the symbol still appears. It's somewhere. It's just have to fall back, but it's not LTO. But it's, of course, it's slower. But anyways, the original idea was if you do slim LTO, it should be faster. It was faster. But we can also, everything that's not LTO must be assembler. So we can just change the compiler to pass it through and generate it on the outside again and generate the object files. That was the original idea. But it was actually, it turned out it was done in a different way. So AJ Liu fixed it in the Linux bin utils. So he added a similar heuristic there where the bin utils detect this case and they basically pass it through when they call the linker plugin. Unfortunately, the problem with this approach, so this worked for me, was that the bin utils mainline didn't want it. So there was something like, we don't learn to use LD-R. And then the discussion stopped because, I mean, I'm not rewriting all the canon make files to not use LD-R. So I was like, okay, just use Linux bin utils then. I mean, if you don't want to support it. So the patches are out there, but they're not in mainline. This just means you have to use the Linux bin utils from AJ Liu currently to do that. This was incremental linking. Then kernel modification. I don't want to go through all of this, but I had to do quite a lot of changes to do things. So I had a pretty large patch. Especially one biggie was section attributes. So the kernel, it marks some data sections and so on as init only, and so that they can be thrown away after the startup of the kernel. But the problem is, they actually, I mean, you have a read-only section, it has to be marked read-only versus read-write. So normally, the normal linker doesn't enforce this. So often people got it wrong. For example, they put the const at the wrong place. So sometimes you get const char versus char star const and so on. This is where exactly you put it. So the problem was that LTO enforces this. So it actually errored out when you put something in a read-write section with a read-only or the other way around. So I did a lot of changes to change this. It was a lot of patches. Most of them got merged right now. The other problem was, I mean, top-level inline assembler. So I'm using FVOL program. And everything, often there people were assuming either that if something is on top level inline assembler and it's in the same file, they can just reference it or the other way around. But if LTO doesn't know about this, it might just discard it because it sees nobody references it. So it essentially means you have to mark everything that's used in an inline assembler and it's using a global symbol. You have to mark the symbol as visible. Yeah? That's one thing. And there were a few related bugs. So sometimes people were assuming that something is in the same file, but because partitioning can actually move things to different files, so sometimes you had problems there, and there were a few changes like this. I had to add a lot of visible, especially also for assembler. Then a big problem was, so GCC essentially, if you use FVOL program, turns everything into static, because it's essentially static. And with static, standard GCC adds like dot number for some reason, adds it to the symbol. And this caused a lot of problems because there are various tools in the kernel. They have some tools which post-processes object exports and a few other things, and they all couldn't deal with this. So I still have at least one feature which doesn't work because of that. It's moduled versions. This is like a text to an exported symbol that takes the type. It generates a hash of the type, and there's still some problem with there. And I had to do a lot of changes on for these number symbols. We had also one interesting change. There are some auto-generated symbols which can be very long, and we overflow a buffer in one of the tools which generates the table for KL-sims, which also caused some really interesting bugs. So I had to also disable LTO for some files. Then 4.7 still has some bugs in the partitioner that sometimes you have to make random things visible, otherwise they disappear. I had to write a GCC LD because LTO you have to call GCC to link because it's, the compiler is linking. But the kernel calls LD. So I did like a wrapper which turns the LD options back into GCC. So it's like a pretty ugly shell script. And a few fixes for optimizations, but they were very rare. So I didn't have a lot of problems with that, but a few ones. So, but it was still a substantial kernel change. And this is, for example, this is the size of my current patch kit. Debugging. So kernel debugging can be more difficult because LTO adds a lot, does a lot additional inlining. Especially, for example, one thing is if you have a static kernel, there's a lot of code which is called at the beginning. And if it's not called indirectly for a constructor, then it all gets inlined in the same function. Because GCC has the heuristic that if something is called only once, you inline it because it's free. So you end up with some really, really big functions. One problem is if something goes wrong in there, normally you can look at the backtrace and see, okay, it happened in this driver or it happened here or there. But if it's all in a single function, then this is much harder. So it makes it somewhat more challenging to look at crashes. I mean, one idea I had is, but it would be quite a bit of work to do this, was to do an inline aware backtracer. So basically look at draft2 information and then get and okay, this region is an inline. We put a marker in there and in the internal symbol tab we could do it. I know he's cringing a little bit. But I think it might be useful in some cases anyways, because in some cases you must still have a lot of inlining. But I'm not sure I want to do this, but it might be a possibility to handle this. So compiler was another problem. I had a lot of compiler bugs. There are a lot of regressions. For example, somebody just added a new patch to the 4.8 branch after the 4.8 release, like in the last month or so, which breaks my build again. And I had a lot of similar problems in the past, so I triggered a lot of interesting compiler bugs. The problem is I don't have simple test cases, because normally you have a file, and you do this, and then the compiler crashes, but I don't have a file. I have a complete build tree, which is really big. so it's actually pretty hard to generate a test case. So it's possible to delta, so try to track down where it is, but it takes a long time. It usually takes me over a day to delta something. So this is definitely a big problem. Another problem is, I mean, it's not traditionally compiler debugging was just a single process. But now, if you looked at some of my graphs before, it's, yes?
Have you only checked how much usage changes in
the LTO? I haven't checked it, but the modern GCC has a heuristic in the inliner which limits stack growth from inlining, and we enable it for the kernel. But I can check it if you want.
I was just wondering, because this used to be a problem for some functions where, few big functions were inlined together into one huge function, and then the stack was really huge for the function.
I believe this has been also improved in modern GCC. Like all the GCC had this problem that it always put all the locals separately, but they added at some point, I don't remember which function, and there was a special change to allocate this more smartly. But it's a good point. Yeah, I should probably check that. No, I haven't checked that. So it's a complex multiprocess. So it actually can be quite difficult if something crashes to just, attach the debugger to the right process, because even if you just start with the linker, it actually goes through multiple calls of different functions, of different programs, until it actually gets down to your compiler. And also attaching it, profiling it, so you had to do some special tools. I found it most useful to debug the compiler to enable core dumps. There's an obscure option called -dh that says if you have if something bad happens, core dump, and then just look at the core dump. I found this is the most simple way to at least see what's going on. So just debugging is definitely a challenge with LTO, both for the compiler and for the kernel. So global optimizations. So what's actually, this was my small config. So I was looking at what's enabled here. So I, for example, had 21K new inlines between files. Of those, we have 13K unique. So there's definitely quite a lot of additional inlining going on from here. By the way, actually, because there's a nice way to dump a debug file in GCC, which gives you all the information, and I actually wanted, I did a script to put it onto GraphWiz and generate a big graph, but it overwhelmed GraphWiz, so the PDF was not readable. I was actually hoping to plot it on a plotter, like they have a large plotter at work, but I think it was too big for that, because I had too many notes. But if somebody wants to have, I still have the PDF, so somebody wants to see it, but it's not very readable. okay, but anyways, so inlining, I got quite a bit new inlines. So Scala replacement, so that means that it breaks up structures and does it on the function level. There was no change on Fundy, so I have a few, but not too many, and it didn't really change it. So partial inlining, that means it inlined only part of the, for example, you always have an if at the beginning, it might inline the if it thinks it's a hot if. So partial inlining, I got quite a few, 16% plus. So constant propagation means it generates generates a special version of the function. For example, it determines that the function is always called with the same argument. So it can actually generate a special version of the function which is optimized for that argument. So you have like a, for example, you always call a function with one, so you generate f.1, and you just constant propagate it in the function. So quite a few more of that 40%. So there's also an optional flag. It's called cloning for constant propagation. So normally it does this constant propagation only when it's unique, so it's always the same argument. But here, with the cloning for constant propagation, it can decide to do multiple versions for this. So it said, okay, there are a lot of calls, but not all calls, but a lot of calls are having this constant argument. So I do a special clone, a special version of this. So I got quite a few of those, like from originally I had 266. So without LTO, I got over 1,000. But unfortunately, it cost me 200K, so 2% tax. So it's a little bit big. So right now, I have it as a config. And it's not clear it's helping all that much. But these are some of the possibilities. So static instruction changes. So I just looked at the VM Linux, comparing it. So I actually have, so these are always the deltas. I have 4% less calls. So definitely, there's a lot of inlining going on. And my functions are over 8% larger on average. But also the standard deviation is also going somewhat up. I have over 8% less pushes. So there's definitely a lot of optimizations going on in terms of register use and so on. And also similar with pops, like 7% less pops. And I have something like 1.8% less moves. So I mean, there are definitely noticeable changes in the generated code. So runtime, I would say there was somewhat mixed. So this, for example, this is currently, this is like what's called LKP, that's a suite of kernel test cases. So on the newer CPUs, there's a small improvement, but not very much. And on the older CPUs, we see some larger improvements. So this might be related to, usually the theory is that the newer CPUs can deal better with worse code. So the older you are, you might deal better with it. There were a few other things. What's the question? Okay. But I mean, I would say that the wins currently are not extremely large, yeah? So we actually tried a few things, tried a few different ones. I mean, one issue is my theory is what's going on is why I don't see large events is the kernel does a lot of indirect function calls. There are a lot of indirect pointers, like, for example, VFS, so you have to look at the pointer. And this is always a barrier for the optimizer. The optimizer cannot look through it. Yeah? So I think one thing I want to try, which I think is very interesting, is to get some kind of devirtualization going. So devirtualization means that you add some hint or use a profiler that most likely this pointer is going here. So essentially you can add an if target is here, inline, otherwise go indirect pointer. So you can actually optimize over this. This is something I want to try. Another thing I want to try is to do atom testing, because atom is a small core, and it's much less tolerant to bad code than a big core. And this is also something I plan in the future. So, but I mean, right now I would say, I mean, there are a few wins, but it's not really compelling at this point in terms of performance for a kernel. But I have some more, there's some more. For example, text size. It actually, for my small config on x86, goes up about 3% in terms of text size. But if you have a really small config, for example, Alno is the smallest config, it goes down by 50k. So I think the reason for that is that the standard kernel has like a library, and the less if you don't use everything, then there are some unused functions. You can throw them away. I should add one problem if there is, it works best when you have a non-modular kernel. Because if you have a modular kernel, then some stuff is exported again, so this prevents it from being from being removed if you don't use it. So generally, LTO works best when you're non-modular, because every module and everything is a barrier for the compiler I can't use. So for example, one thing I had from Tim Bird, he was interested, he ported LTO to ARM, and he was very interested like in text size. And he got some improvement on text size. That was with 4.7. So I think he was happy. As he got a slightly faster boot, but it's not a big improvement. So, but for example, this was one thing. This is an embedded system. It's relatively small config. So they were interested in using this, and they're really fighting for every byte on the flash. So that's fair. So it helps somewhat there. So GCC improvements I would like to have. So especially per file options, this actually breaks some stuff for me, that there's no way to set a different option for different files. So the most common case is, and I have a partial patch for it, but it's not integrated right now, is so there's, for example, the function graph tracer in kernel, which instrument every function, just uses instrument function, but it has to be disabled for some files where it doesn't work. But right now, when you cannot disable something per file because all the options apply to everything in LTO. So there has to be some changes there. Then fixed passing through of options. So in theory, if you specify option at the object file build, it should be used at the end in LTO. In theory, it actually has code to do this, but it only works for something like half the options. So actually, I had to manually hack up my make files to do this. This is also something that could be improved. Right now, it doesn't work very well. Like having a standard GCC LD, so when the make file calls LD versus GCC for linking, you need a standard wrapper. So right now I have my private wrapper, but it would be much better if there was a standard wrapper. Then don't error for section mismatches. I already mentioned this. This is just a pain. As far as I know, it's completely useless because there shouldn't be any reason why you error out when this happens. The better procedure for LTO error reporting. I think that's really important because, I mean, at least I hit a lot of bugs. And I can kind of deal with them, but I'm not sure that everybody can deal with them. So I think there needs to be a better way to generate test cases from LTO, maybe some automated delta procedure or whatever. But right now, this, for the compiler, it's a big issue. So another problem I had is type mismatch, I fortunately didn't have a lot of them, but if you have a type mismatch, that means that something is different between header files, but it appears like the same type, then LTO cannot deal with it. Everything has to be the same type, so essentially from the same header file. So right now you just get a very cryptic error, and it can be hard to figure out because if, for example, the type mismatch is not in your top-level type, but somewhere in the bottom of an indirect struct, because every struct that's referenced is part of the type, yeah, then it can be very challenging to figure out where actually the type mismatch is. So the current, as far as I know, the current best way to do this is to, there's a special patch from Richard Beener to add to GCC, and then you have, but then you have to do GDB on GCC and call a special function to debug it. That's currently the best way to do it. So this is definitely not very good. So for type mismatches, I think there just need to be much better error messages. Then the XXX post fixes. I believe there's already some work on this, but as far as I know, it hasn't been really fixed yet. Another problem I had was top level reorder, because originally I have to, so normally when GCC does partitioning, it will freely reorder everything to fit the partitions well, so that the partitions fit the call graph. But the kernel has what's called init calls. These are essentially constructors, but they're done in a custom way. And these init calls cannot be reordered, because the code doesn't tolerate it when some init call, which used to be late, is suddenly early. I had a lot of problems with that, but then I have to use what's called FNode top-level reorder, but they're only needed for the init calls. And it would be nice if it either was per symbol, so I don't have to disable everything. I did some measurements. I'm losing some inlining because of this, because the inlining, the top-level reordering changes the partitioning, and then it cannot match the partitions as well as it could to the call graph, and you can only inline inside a partition. So it, essentially, the disabling the reordering changes the inlining. So either would have to have it per symbol, or some other solution for this. Another thing that's really a pain currently is, especially if you have assembler, is to manually figure out what needs to be externally visible. So it would be nice if there was an automated tool, because you could actually, I think you could discover it at the linker level with a plugin or something like this. And the other problem is also, so when you have something, for example, a function which is called by a top-level inline assembler, so right now the only way to handle this is to also make it visible. But actually it would be better if you could mark the inline function to just say this references something. This would be, for example, the same thing is with a static. So sometimes people call statics, but the only way to describe it actually is currently to make it global. Because otherwise you cannot, there's no other way to say this is used by something else, which is the assembler. So I think this is something that should be fixed in GCC, if possible. So status, I mean, it kind of works on x86. That's what I primarily use, ARM and MIPS. So Tim Bird is doing ARM and Ralf Bechle is doing MIPS. It's up to date with Linux 3.8. And some options are still disabled, especially function trace, kernel coverage and mod versions due to some of these problems mentioned. Okay, that's what I have. Here's just my references, and I'm open to questions.